Okay, y'all, welcome to the Luxury Investment Podcast by Currently Carter. I am your host, Carter. It's so nice to be here with you. Thank you so much for listening or watching on my YouTube channel, Currently Carter, if you're over there. Let's get into today's episode because it's going to be a good one. Today's episode is Hermès, what is the tea on how to get a bag? One of my most frequently asked questions over on my Instagram, which is also, of course, at Currently Carter. I have an awesome, amazing community over there that I chat with all the time. And one of the subjects we talk about a lot is Hermès, because Hermès inherently is probably the pinnacle, the most sought after as far as investment value bags that you can buy. And we talked a little bit about this in episode one. What is a luxury investment? What is investment shopping? Well, we talked about the fact that Hermès bags are the poster child to this concept of buying something that immediately appreciates in value right when you walk out of the store, and that is because of scarcity. You cannot just go into an Hermès store and buy a bag. You have to get offered one. That is the Hermès game. That is the whole marketing strategy of, you cannot just buy it. You have to get offered it. Therefore, it is perceived as much, much more valuable than even it is, or even the goods actually cost, because, of course, in social psychology alone, we automatically associate something that is hard to get with very valuable. Okay, let's get into the tea, all the details. I kind of pride myself on doing a ton of research on this concept alone, only because I'm super interested in the investment side of it, and I just love watching business strategy alone. So I kind of have a unique take on this whole game, I think, than the average connoisseur or the average collector, because I really look at it from a business perspective and because I know all the games, right? I've watched all the interviews. I've watched all the people that have gotten all the bags, and I have a well-rounded take on how it works. Okay, let's get into like what Hermès bags are. Here's the deal. This is very similar to even the luxury watch brands and how to get, a luxury watch and how to get anything that is highly sought after or coveted in a specific brand is you have to develop a relationship with a sales associate. You will hear a lot of collectors or people that buy luxury in general talk about SAs. SAs is the abbreviation for sales associate. Now, you will have specific brands that actually use specific abbreviations for their brand alone. For example, like Louis Vuitton will use FA for fashion advisor. Chanel, for example, uses CA, client advisor. In general, it's just a general term, SA. Okay, so you go into Hermès, you meet a sales associate, and you hit it off, and now you guys can either do two things. You buy from her one time, you leave, you walk away, and you never see her again. Next time you go into a store, you get a brand new sales associate, and so on and so forth. That's how you would typically shop at, let's say, a department store, right? That is not how you ever, ever, ever want to shop at a luxury store. A luxury store, you want to develop a relationship with someone specifically, and this is how really all luxury stores work, and they really kind of thrive off of the relationship. Both of you do. You thrive off the relationship because they can offer you things that are hard to get or give you a heads up. For example, when twice a year, typically luxury brands will do a particular sale, and if you get first dibs, you get best items, and if you get best items for lower cost, you have better investment value. So these people are your best friends. and I should probably do a whole another episode on like how to develop a relationship with an SA, best practices, a lot of things, maybe behind the scenes. Maybe I'll even bring on one of my SAs for a bit of an interview. That might be kind of fun, but let's just go ahead and plan on making that episode 3. I think that will be a great episode. That's another frequently asked question that I get. So, a sales associate are your gateway into whatever store for a lot of different reasons. Like we talked about sales, hard to get items, or bags. Now, you want to make sure that if you're looking to develop a brand new relationship with an SA in a particular store, that they are not seasonal and that they are not in an internship. So, a lot of times I wouldn't just straight out come out with that as the first thing. Hi, are you an internship? But you might, throw it into the conversation like, oh, how long have you worked here? Like, this is such a beautiful store. It's my first time in, whatever, right? They are constantly looking for clients as well, unless there are long seasoned SA, they've been there for a very long time. Chances are they probably have a good solid clientele. That is can benefit you or be a detriment to, really, right? Depending on their clientele, if they have a certain client that spends a ton of money with them, right? So much money. They're maybe top 2% in the whole store. And you are now also with that SA. If that SA gets offered a bag, they're probably going to offer it to another client that gets a higher percentage and has been there with them longer, right? Overall buying percentage. So it's kind of a bit of a game that you don't really have any say in playing, you know, as far as like, it's not like you can go through their clientele, but I'm just kind of giving you the background to different hints or different things that you can kind of gather that might enable you to kind of try to pick the best essay that you can, right? Because you want to give yourself the best chances. Now, let's say you have your essay, right? Typically, you just want to present yourself that you know how this game works, right? That you know that they are looking for clients that spend, you know, consistently, and they are looking to develop relationships with that client. They don't necessarily make commission on how much sales. Most of the time, in most luxury stores, they all make a bonus collectively based on how much the store sells. So you get a little bit of kudos for having a really good client because it helps your overall store numbers, but it's not necessarily directly associated with their commission, especially in Hermès. It is not like that specifically. They actually cannot buy any quota bags. A quota bag is a bag that you have to get offered from Hermès, and you can only buy two a year. Therefore, they're called quota bags. Some other Hermès bags that you can buy multiple of, and you're not limited on how many you can buy in 1 year with that one store. And that's how they sort of get around people buying them for their mom or their friend or whatever. They're really buying them for themselves, because obviously Hermès is not lost on knowing that instantly when they walk out of the store, these bags are worth three times their value, right? Okay. What are the kinds of bags that everybody is seeking so much at Hermès? There's kind of a top 10 tier, if you will. This is, you know, like not in any particular order, like it's not the law or anything. It's just kind of my opinion over what, like in everyone's kind of sort of general opinion. Number one, you have the Birkin. Now, Birkins are the top handle bag that you see have two handles. It's the easiest way to differentiate the two between the next on our list, which is number two, which would be the Kelly. The Kelly is a single top handle bag, meaning there's just one handle and it's a flap bag, similar to what you would see in sort of like a Chanel. It is a flap. It goes over a piece of hardware and then it turns to lock the bag in place. Birkins also have a turning mechanism on the front, but it doesn't have one single handle at the top. It has two, and the flap sort of sits inside the bag, so you can also wear it open. Whereas a Kelly, you can't wear the bag open. You do have to close it if you want to walk around with the bag being closed, meaning like it's not just literally flapping completely open, like it looks like it's open. Does that make sense? you'll know exactly what I'm talking about if you ever see a Kelly on the street. Number three would be the Constance. Constance is a crossbody bag. You'll see an H on the front in the hardware. It has a mechanism that opens in the center of the H, and it's a flap to open. Again, it is technically a crossbody bag, although you can kind of do a special trick with a Twilly and make the strap go up sort of in the center to kind of create a faux top handle, if you will. And that's kind of a fun little trick that you can do with a Constance. But in general, it is created to just be a crossbody. Those top three are what we call the quota bags. You can only buy two a year with one boutique. Now, up until this point, this has been a big rumor that Hermès is officially doing that as of last December. I have yet to like fully confirm that with Paris itself. So I'm curious next time I go to Paris to like fully confirm this rumor. But up until this point, prior to December, their global database has not been connected, meaning you can go to Paris, get a quota bag, get offered a Birkin, right? Get that Birkin, and then go back to your local store in the US and also get offered a bag if you're lucky enough. And now all of a sudden you have two different bags from two different stores, and arguably you can kind of go around traveling all over Europe trying to get a bag at every single Hermès store, and boom, you have multiple bags in 1 year that is past the quota. That's what a lot of people do whenever they end up with, you know, quite a few bags that are just sort of hunting, and they have the means and the finances to do that. They just go hunting through all of the stores, and it's a bit of, you know, the millionaire's game, if you will, where it's, you know, a fun hunt because you don't know if they have a shipment in, if you can get lucky, et cetera, et cetera. And that's kind of leads us into like, how do you get a bag? right? But before we get into that, let's kind of do that top 10 like I was talking about. You have the top three quota bags. In number fourth place, you have the Piquetin. The Piquetin is another top handle bag that opens. It looks like a little bucket bag. It has the classic Hermès lock on the front, and it's just overall a pretty cute little bag. Then you have in number five spot, the Evelyn. Evelyn is a crossbody bag that has a perforated H on the front with a circle around it. They're like a good starter bag if you're interested in getting a Birkin and you're trying to get your spend up with an essay in order to get offered a bag. You typically need to have a significant buying history with that particular essay in order to get offered a bag. There's kind of a loose term reference, depending on the store, that you need to buy the same amount in the store on other items as it costs to get a Birkin. So roughly that's around $10,000 in other just general items. And then once you make that quota, then you can get offered a Birkin. Places like Dubai, for example, are very strict on this because they have lots of buyers and lots of requests for Birkins. So it kind of depends on where you are, how strict that particular store is and how strict that management is, right? Which we'll get into later. Garden Party might actually be directly after the Evelyn in number six's place. The Garden Party is the Hermès tote bag, and there's lots of different colorways, lots of different materials and leathers, etc. And the little stamp on the front has Hermès Paris. It's just a pretty classic shape. Again, it's pretty subtle. Number seven is the Lindy. Now, the Lindy, again, is quite a unique bag. It's, again, a top handle bag, but it's sort of offset where the strap handles that your arm goes through, instead of it being as a typical bag, let's say it's front facing, they're on each side of the bag, which is kind of a unique look. And then of course in number eight is the Bodily. Bodily is another top handle bag. It's like a classic shape, and it doesn't have very many inherently obvious Hermès symbols on it whatsoever. It's probably the most subtle bag of them all. Number nine, maybe the Jasper. The Jasper is a crossbody that has a similar lock to the Kelly. It's very cute. A lot of people really like that crossbody bag. Again, a great Birkin bait bag in quotations, where they make a lot of them. They're not necessarily a lot of people seeking those bags specifically compared to how many people are seeking quota bags. So if you want to play the game, then you might ask, instead of, hey, do you have a Birkin? Do you have a Kelly? Do you have a Constance? You say, hey, do you have any Lindys available or any Jaspers? Or do you have maybe number 10's place, which is the Her bag? The Her bag is the newest bag from Hermès, and it is a canvas bag, actually. I do believe they might also make it in leather at this point, but it did come out initially in canvas, and it's similar to the Kelly, and it's the same style that it has the flap and a lock on the front, although the lock has two like leather pieces that go through a sort of button in the front. And it's a really cute bag overall. Again, the newest bag, the newest release from Hermès. So a lot of people liked it just for the sake of the fact that it's, you know, brand new. Another really cute, easy run around town kind of bag. Okay, so let's go into how to get offered a bag. This is what I call the local store. There's three overall strategies that you can use to get offered a bag. I call them Paris, local store, and the lucky break. What we touched on earlier is really what I'm referencing when I'm talking about the local store. You have an essay that you regularly go to. You walk into Hermès and you pick an essay and you say, hey, you know, I'm looking to start investing more in Hermès. I like the pillows and maybe a blanket and, oh, like these twillies are so pretty, maybe some scarves, whatever, right? You're looking to get your buying history up with that particular essay. And then you might, you know, tell that essay that you're interested in some leather goods. And if they ever get shipments in, you'd be very interested in seeing them. But, you know, until then, you're interested in just buying some items for your home or different things that you're interested that you've had your eye on for a while. And they would obviously be glad to tell you, and they get the hint that you're interested in a bag, right? There's kind of two different strategies here. One is you're super subtle. You don't say anything. You're not like forthright about what you're interested in. And the other one is you're really forthright and you know exactly what they want. So this is a really touchy comparison because on the one hand, you have personalities that come into account, right? Overall, every Hermès employee knows that you want a Birkin because it's the most appreciating asset item that they offer. And everybody that shops at Hermès, you know, pretty much a generalization, once a Birkin, once a Kelly, once a quota bag. And so coming out saying like, hey, do you have any Birkins? They're going to tell you no. They have very strict rules on how they can offer Birkins to clients. Pretty much your first time meeting a SA, they're not allowed to sell you a Birkin. Now, that's not to say that never happens, but usually what will happen if you are going to get lucky in that sort of situation, and I'm jumping here to what I call the lucky break, which we'll go over in depth a little bit later, but it's not impossible. And again, we'll go into that in just a second. I want to stay on track with the local store, okay? If you are talking to your SA, right, and you're interested in getting one and you're like too, you know, upfront or forthright, they might say like, oh, no, we don't have any stock in right now. That's like kind of the infamous quote, if you will, of essays. They always tell you they don't have stock. And then you see someone walk out with a Birkin and you're like, oh, you don't have stock? Well, like, look at like what? You know, and then it's like, it's been memed over and over and over again, right? Now, because of that, like, unofficial rule that they can't offer you a bag right when you walk in the store, they might say, oh, but you can come back and check in, you know, tomorrow, et cetera, something like that, right? Where they say something like, if you come back in specifically to look at something else and they happen to have stock then at that point, they're already your client and they're allowed to offer you a bag. Now, this is not an exact science. I don't know this particularly exactly because all of this is always so much hearsay, right? But based on all of the, you know, interviews that I've watched and all of my personal experience and my friend's personal experience, this is my assumption, right? This is my, you know, overarching assumption that there's some sort of rule there that they cannot offer you specifically something like that when you first walk in. But if they finagle it or have you come back in for something, then maybe they can at that point. It does have to get approved by a manager typically, especially if they're a younger associate, where they say like, hey, I want to offer this particular bag to this client. And it's either, you know, approved or denied kind of depending on the situation. I'm not sure if that's just a young SA thing and if older SAs have the authority to decide one way or another. But again, just sort of my observation on how many different essays I've worked with, et cetera. Okay, that is local store, right? So in that local store, let's say you have a good buying history with that essay at this point, you've bought different things for your home in different categories. A lot of people say that you can't just only buy click-clack bracelets, which click-clack is a specific kind of Hermès bracelet, and, you know, like lipsticks and expect to get offered a Birkin, that you need to prove yourself to the store, prove yourself to the essay that you are a fan of the brand, that you appreciate the history, the craftsmanship, the overall brand itself, and you want different things from different departments, right? Because you're interested in the brand itself, and therefore you would be a good model or a spokesperson to get offered a bag and wear the bag and show it to your different friends because, again, you're a true fan of the brand. That's kind of, in general, the overall, like, feel, the overall, like, you know, again, this is very different depending on what store you're going to and how hard it is to get a bag for that store because how many clients buy way more than maybe your budget allots in that store, right? Like what rank do you have in the buying history of that store? If you're in Dallas, Texas, for example, versus New York, those buying differences are going to be huge, right? You have big buyers in Dallas, that's for sure. But the capita rate, for example, of how many big buyers are in New York versus are in Texas are going to be higher in New York for sure. So arguably, it's going to be always harder to get a bag in New York than it is in Texas. But that being said, Hermès New York probably gets a lot more shipment to supply that demand in New York than they do in Texas. So does it even out? Maybe. It's kind of a guessing game. Let's go into the lucky break. That's what I was talking about before, where maybe you get super lucky. There's a bag that's been passed on twice. Somebody doesn't want to spend the money because they really want a Birkin 30, and this is a Birkin 35, and they just like want to save. It's a quota bag. It's their last quota bag of the year, and they don't want to spend money on something that they're going to hold out for and wait for like a Birkin 30, meaning 30 centimeters. There's different sizes of each of these bags, and the different sizes depending on the season, the year, And just, you know, the overall trends itself mean different bags are going to be more desirable or less desirable. For example, when the micro trend really kicked off, the mini Kellys and smaller Birkin 25s were much, much, much more popular than a Birkin 35 or a Birkin 40, right? A Birkin 35 is more of a larger-ish bag. I would say that it's typically a lot smaller than people think it is. People always reference as Birkin 35s as being, you know, quite large and, you know, they overwhelm the body frame. And it's really not the case. Unless you are particularly small and particularly petite, it really just looks like an average size bag or an average size larger bag on a average frame. It does fit a laptop, so it is, you know, like a small tote sort of size, getting into like a medium large, you know, version. Now, a Birkin 40 is much bigger, of course, another 5 centimeters, and that would be more of like a bag you might take on top of your luggage as a personal item on a plane, something like that, right? Now, let's say it's a Birkin 35, and what everybody wants right now is a Birkin 25. They want the smaller bag, so they might have a 35 because someone might have passed on it because they're holding out for a Birkin 25. You walk in, two people have passed on that bag. They say, oh, no, we don't have any stock, but is there anything else that I can offer you? And you say, like, oh, yeah, like, I might buy a few things here or there. Now you have some skin in the game. You've bought something with that essay. They know you're a serious buyer. Maybe they say, you know what, come back tomorrow. We might get a shipment in. You come back tomorrow and you might get offered that Birkin 35 because they happen to have the stock in hand, right? That's the lucky break. Now you have the really, really lucky breaks where the store happens to just get stock in. They don't have a buyer lined up. Maybe this is in Mexico, for example. There's less buyers in Mexico than maybe there is in New York. That Mexico store just got a fresh shipment in, and now that particular essay gets allotted a bag. They're allowed to sell a bag. The other essays in the store already have their clients, already have their big buyers in Mexico City or, you know, wherever we're talking about, and they get allotted all of their bags already, but you have like a newer essay that gets allotted a bag, and they don't have a client lined up for it yet. You walk in, and you say like, hi, you just hit it off. And you guys are like killing it. You are just like vibing. You might buy a few things from him. And he says, hey, if you have time and you're interested, you might come back in. We might have something for you. And you walk in and he offers you a freaking epic, like keen, perfect bag for the season. It is a 25 Togo leather noir, which is obviously black. All of the colors in Hermès bags are always referenced in French, of course, because it's a French brand. And gold hardware, you know, where it's like this, the pinnacle of what a lot of people search for. But you got really lucky because they were allotted that bag and they didn't have a buyer lined up because they, you know, are a newer essay or someone that is, you know, I say a newer essay, I think in order to be to the point where you can offer bags to people, you do have to be there for a certain amount of time and have a certain amount of training. So but you know, whatever stage they are in their career, and you got a really, really lucky break. And of course, they just picked you, right? They picked you to offer the bag to, and they're giving you the opportunity to buy it, obviously at cost, when typically to buy those bags, they're so hard to find. Even with your regular essays, a lot of people just buy them on the secondary market. They buy it, you know, double the cost because it's just easier than continuing to buy with an essay if they don't actually know if that essay has the ability to offer them that bag or not. They're not sure where they are in the ranks, where they are at the store. You know, there's lots of variables here, which is why a lot of people just say, I don't want to play that game. I'll buy on the secondary market, or I don't want to play the game at all. And you go to Chanel because, you know, Chanel has a lot of appreciating value as well. There's a lot more items of Chanel that appreciate in value over time, like the vintage jewelry and the 24 karat gold vintage jewelry and the 24 karat gold gilded bags that are pre-2008, for example. So, you know, there's other things that you can play with. It's not like Hermès is the one and only, but it is usually a general goal for any collector, any bag collector, to own an Hermès bag at some point in their collecting history. Okay, which leads us to the third and final way to score a quota bag from Hermès, and that is Paris. Paris is its own world. Paris has its own rules, and Paris is obviously in France, and Hermès is a French brand, so Paris is where the Hermès flagship store is called Paris Rue Cambon. And that store has its special system because everybody wants to travel to Paris and get offered a Birkin from the flagship store in Rue Cambon. It is like the pinnacle of every collector's dream. If you're interested in buying a bag, you would love to get offered in Paris on your 10th anniversary or your 30th birthday or, you know, whatever it might be. And so they have a special system where you can get lucky and score a Birkin without a buying history in Paris because of this system. Now, this system used to be you got up at 4 a.m. and lined up outside the door at Hermès, and right when they opened at 10 a.m., they would come out and they would hand you a ticket, and they would only hand out so many tickets for how many essays they had available and how many appointments they had that day open. And you would take your ticket, your lucky ticket, and you would go about your day, and then you would come back and hand them your ticket whenever your appointment was assigned. Since then, a couple years ago, they changed the system completely to what we call the lottery system. The lottery system is you cannot line up, you cannot get a ticket, you cannot do anything at all physically to get an appointment at Hermès. You can only sign up on the Hermès website with your passport and pray to the lottery gods that you get an appointment the next day, 24 hours later. You can only apply every 24 hours with a passport in order to get an appointment, but you can try with as many passports as you can. So, you know, your daughter's passport, your husband's passport, your dog's passport, all of the passports go into the system in hopes that somebody gets an appointment within 24 hours. And you can try that every single day that you're in Paris, of course. But I will say it is very important to note, I had made the same mistake when I was in Paris last. If you apply for an appointment on Saturday, it is going to be for the next Monday because Hermès is closed on Sundays. So you cannot apply for a Sunday appointment, and you're going to apply. In that case, it's like 48 hours ahead of time. So, of course, it did not work out well. So you just want to keep that in mind if you are going for this particular strategy. Okay, let's say you get lucky, you try every single day, you get an appointment, you go in, and they say, what are you looking for? Now, everyone is going to say a Birkin, a Kelly, a Constance, right? That is what, and then it's just like, okay, they go back to the back, they see what they have in stock, and if it matches what you're saying, then maybe you get offered, maybe you don't. It's really like very much discretion of the essay. They only have so many bags that they can offer, so they're picking you, right? They're picking you based on what you're telling them, based on how maybe well you get along, based on if they truly have it or not, right? Like maybe they love you and you guys hit it off and you have the best time ever, but they just don't have anything close to what you're asking for. And it does have to be within a certain range in order for them to offer you something, right? You want to know the different sizes of the bags. You want to know the different colors. You want to know the different leathers, because it just shows that you're educated about Hermès. If you say like, I don't know, just like a black one, like whatever you have in black, I really want, you know, versus someone saying, yeah, I'd really be interested in anything that is maybe under a size 35. I think over a 35 is just maybe too big for my frame. I'd love something in noir, and I am a gold hardware kind of girl. If it was palladium, I might be okay, but I would much, much prefer gold hardware. That's kind of a deal breaker for me. So if you get anything in gold hardware, I'd be interested to see it, something like that, right? And they're going to mark down, okay, noir, and maybe you have like another color or something. Like you say, oh, I would also really like gold, which is like a tan color in Hermès, if you're already a collector. I already have a Birkin in a 35, and I'm really interested in getting a smaller size. The color is less important to me than really the size. So if you just get in a color that you think that I would like, I'd love to see it. A lot of strategy goes into how you talk to this essay whenever you go to Paris. Overall, not asking initially for a bag seems to work out the best, where you go in and you ask maybe for a clutch or a wallet or something that they definitely have. And you say, absolutely perfect, I love that one. And you buy it. And then you say, do you think you have any stock in particularly maybe a Birkin 30 in a neutral color? Or maybe you have three colors you're working on specifically and you know the colors in French and you say those colors in French, and she might say, oh, like now she knows you're a serious buyer, not just only Birkin seeking. You're not only coming in for a Birkin and nothing else. And like maybe she'll be more inclined, or he might be more inclined, to look in the back for you to see if anything fits within that category. The longer they're gone, the better. every time consistently somebody waits like 30 minutes in their Birkin story, it's always good news because they're searching, right? They're searching, they're finding, and then they're getting approved, and then they can offer it to you. If it's cellophane wrapped when they're offering it to you, it is the first time anybody has seen that bag. It hasn't been passed over at all because the cellophane is still on it. So that is like fresh off the truck, if you will. And that's just like a little fun thing to note, right? So yeah, I have heard many times that the better luck you get whenever you're getting offered a Birkin is that you just don't seem like you are only seeking the only thing that, you know, has the best resale value, because they're trying to avoid selling Birkins to resellers. They want to sell Birkins and Kellys and quota bags to people that truly love the brands and not someone's just going to turn around and flip it for a profit. So you would obviously never ever want to say anything like that or anything to clue them in whatsoever to if that's, you know, what you're trying to do or that's your goal, because that is definitely going to get a no from them, because that is, again, their rule. Those are kind of the three overall versions of how to get offered a quota bag in Hermès. Now, again, all of these are sort of opinions, different things that I have gleaned from a lot of different experiences myself, my friends' experiences, etc. So you can definitely get lucky. I've heard so many people get lucky, right? They walk in and they're generally interested in the brand. They want to start spending with them. They're interested in getting a Birkin later, and they just happen to get an SA who just they hit it off with, and they happen to have stock. And because there's already that sense of trust where they weren't just coming in seeking a Birkin specifically, they get offered, right? But typically, as an overall suggestion, it is ideal for you to go in and be interested in something else besides just the bag, and then casually mention it whenever you're feeling comfortable or you feel the time is right. Another way to bring it up is to say, I'd love to get on a wish list with you. Some boutiques use wish lists specifically, and they like have wish lists more than they use at discretion via the essays. Again, all kinds of boutiques are a little bit different. So that might even be a great way to bring it up with the essay. Like, hey, do you guys work off of wish lists for quota bags? I'd love to open a wish list with you for whenever you get a shipment in eventually. And they might say, oh yeah, like you can open a wish list. We don't necessarily really go off wish lists. It's really just what we get in and of course buying history or, you know, something like that. And you can have this conversation and it be fun and lighthearted and not too, you know, intense. And you definitely don't want to be texting them later like, hey, have you got another, you know, shipment in, and like, you know, barter them in any way. You want to finagle this and use this as an opportunity of networking and playing lightly, but still being their top of mind, right? And you can do that a couple of different ways. You can do that by buying more, or you can do that by being kind, right? And maybe sending them like a, hey, like, I know you mentioned your birthday this month, happy birthday, or like, hey, Merry Christmas. I hope your family's doing wonderful. And just like, let me know if you ever, if you have this particular item that is not a Birkin, right? Like, and because you're interested in buying it genuinely, right? And you want to make sure that you're buying it with them. You might say like, hey, I saw this Rodeo, which is like a charm that goes on a bag, and I absolutely loved it in this color. Do you think you could let me know if you ever get it in? I'd love to get literally anything in that color, something like that, right? And they're like, yeah, absolutely. You know, I'll let you know. And you're just genuine and kind goes very long way over spending money. I've heard essays say it over and over again. They will offer something to someone who is kind to them way over someone that is just a big spender with them, because everybody likes kindness. Everybody likes actual genuine connection, right? And enjoying somebody's presence and having a good, you know, business relationship with someone. That's overall the tips and tricks that I have for you. Please comment anything down below, any questions, and we'll definitely do a review on maybe an episode of Just Frequently Asked Questions or just different questions about Birkins and Kellys and Hermès. Definitely go over to my Instagram at Curly Carter, and you can ask anything there under the comments, and I will get back to you as well. It's a great place to do it. Or, of course, my YouTube channel, which is, again, Currently Carter, and I'd love to see you there. If you love listening to these podcasts and you are a visual person, I do record a video version of all of them and post them to my channel every Saturday for now, but I will continue to record this series at least once a week. We might even get to twice a week. And I'd love you to rate this podcast for me to try to get it up in the rankings as I'm just starting out. And I'll see you guys next time. Bye.